You were described by one of the reviewers I was reading this week as someone who writes about outsiders who join established institutions, the country music world, the CIA. You compared football players to CIA agents as people who we think we understand, but whose process is totally obscured. So now I've read a couple of reviews of this book, four or five, and a few of them have called it the best book on football they've ever read. I would have to say that it seems that you took the nerd route to get here. There's so much inside football in this book. Nikki even describes how much food the players eat on the airplanes. And it's just, it's an amazing read, and there's a lot of warmth and closeness and a lot of really, like, clear-eyed sense-making of every aspect of an OCD, data-driven, computerized coaching system in overdrive, as well as a view into the athlete's world. So just to sort of start off, you were an athlete in college, right?
A little bit. First, I just want to echo and say thank you all so much for coming. It's such a busy time of year, and it's such a terrible night outside, so it's very gratifying and flattering. And it's also for me and for Matt both, we're like everybody else who does what we do. We're just eternally grateful to independent bookstores because I don't know, I guess I think of that old Emmylou Harris song, you know, and I guess Steve Earle wrote it, "We're nothing without you." I mean, this is everything to us. So thank you, and thank you so much for having us. And I played a little bit of baseball into college, more entirely based on enthusiasm than on any real ability. But when you're not that good a player, one of the things it means you have to pay more attention to what you're doing, I guess.
Uh-huh.
And one of the things I paid a special attention to were my coaches. And one of the things that I began to see immediately as I, you know, became a part of things in the Jets facility is that I had wonderful coaches, sure, but there's a reason that the people who are coaching in the NFL are coaching in the NFL. There are qualities to those people. I guess what I would say is when it occurred to me in a most signal way would be after losses. There's nothing like losing in the NFL. I mean, in baseball, if you have a 10-game losing streak, that's like one NFL loss. These people are spending all their time, to the exclusion of everything else in life, preparing for games. And when they lose, it is devastating. And you walk into the facility on Monday morning, and if they've played on the West Coast, they still come home. So they've got home at 6 o'clock in the morning. They're back at 9 to start watching the game tape and analyzing what they've done. And it's like tonight, later, when there's tree limbs on the ground and broken glass and overturned garbage cans and cars that are askew. It's like the portrait of depression. And by Wednesday, they're over it. And they're over it in such a way that they can look forward to the next opponent, but that they can also look on their team and the people whose job it is to inspire and give them, I mean, it's a very authentic culture, and they can inspire them with a real sense of optimism and confidence. And not everybody could do that. I don't think I could do that. And so in addition to being wonderful teachers of the technical aspects of the game, I just found them in that way a very inspiring and often seductive people to be around, especially Coach Ryan. He's one of the more seductive people I've ever been around.
And a beautiful man. I was going to ask you, though.
As he is the first always to say.
Yes. And he's
looking so handsome today, Nikki.
Yeah, well, he's gotten much more beautiful since you were with him, too. But I want to preface this by saying, and then I want to ask you if you could read about your finger?
My finger, sure.
That's one you can read to us from,
I can
right?
definitely read about
so,
my finger.
And I guess I want to preface this by saying that I was reading Ronnie Lott's autobiography. He was a killer, awesome linebacker for the 49ers. And he tells this story, which is probably not widely known by fans. Anybody here who know the story I'm about to tell, just raise your hand. So he got his hand caught between his helmet and an opponent's helmet. And he tore off the end of his pinky. And it flew away, and he never found it. And it made me think about how athletes use their bodies in ways that regular people, even athletic people, just are not sort of aware of, and we're just it seems kind of foreign to us. So I guess I wanted to ask you a little bit about that, but maybe you could sort of read this section.
Sure. Pain is an enormous part of football. I mean, both physical pain, because it's such a dangerous and violent sport, but also emotional pain. A lot of the people who are attracted to football and who play it, sure, they're astonishing athletes, and they're drawn to a sport which allows them to be very aggressive in, can we say, a constructive way. But it's also true that a lot of football players have grown up in painful environments, and football gives them a chance. Many of them are from impoverished single-parent homes, quite a few of them. I met several who were orphans. And I, to a man, they all talked about that, and they talked about the way in which the game gave them things that they hadn't had in childhood. But of course, we're talking now about physical pain, and there was a lot of it. With when Rex Ryan is your coach, there's a lot of tedium involved in football. The day-to-day in football involves doing things over and over and over again to achieve a level of, can we say, choreographed perfection that is very elusive. And that often can be boring. And so Rex injects a lot of fun into his practices, particularly on Friday, which is the traditional NFL last practice of the week. And so once that's done, they play all sorts of games. And one of the games was a game called Crossbar, where the coaches, several coaches, and several players would stand on the 20-yard line, which makes it 30 yards away from the goalpost. And it was called goalpost, and you had to hit the crossbar. It was called crossbar.
So you didn't invent the game?
I did not invent the game. You had to hit crossbar. I was, in fact, as in all other ways, I was an intruder into the game. But so there are two goalposts, and you can't hit the goalpost. You just hit the crossbar, and the first guy to hit the crossbar three times wins. And this was taken very, very seriously. These are very competitive people, and they let me play. So sometimes I would hit the crossbar in part because, well, they threw beautiful spirals. My end over end gave me a higher possibility of actually hitting the crossbar. So we are playing the crossbar game, and you all know that Darrell Revis is the astonishingly talented all-pro cornerback of the Jets. After practice, while playing the crossbar game, somebody threw a ball back toward me, and as I reached for it, Darrell Revis decided he wanted the ball and was instantly in front of me, abruptly, violently intercepting it by grabbing the ball and pivoting off my extended index finger. There was a splintering sensation. The index finger quickly resembled a tie-dyed sausage casing, a swirl of red, green, yellow, and purple. I didn't tell anyone. Given the culture, keeping it to myself seemed the thing to do. By Saturday morning, my finger was a line of Rocky Mountain ridges. I went to the training room where I was given a cup filled with ice and slush. The cup attracted attention. Soon, all the players in the training room were showing me their digital manglings. Rob Turner had a finger bent into a left turn arrow. It turned out Scotty McKnight had been catching passes with curled tree sloth claws. At the walkthrough, these demonstrations continued. Matt Slauson had dislocated every finger at one point or another and said he had fingernails torn off all the time. Mike Devlin, the tight ends coach, was a former NFL lineman. In retirement, he reserved half of his desk surface as a staging area for bottles of Advil and Aleve, and said that over the years he'd suffered so many injuries playing on the lines of Iowa, Buffalo, and Arizona that sometimes he'd overlook a new one and his wife would discover it, like something under the couch cushion. Alas, left guard Brandon Moore informed me that proper NFL hand protocol was not to ice anything short of a ruptured tendon or ligament. I hung my head. There's a difference between being hurt and being injured, Nikki, defensive coordinator Mike Pettin added. Others were more forgiving. Receivers coach Henry Ellard recalled that when he was a collegian, a freshman quarterback threw a short pass at him so hard, I got a compound fracture. No blood, just a bone sticking out. It was pearl white. The trainer told me, don't look. I got a lot of stitches and I played on Saturday. Then Ellard warned me not to believe everything about fingers, especially the linemen. They're a bunch of teddy bears, he said. Darrell Revis agreed. He explained that the lineman's tactic was to walk into the training room on some pretext. Ah, my leg hurts. And then, said Reeve, casually mentioned, and there's this funny thing with my pinky. Take a quick look at it. Head trainer John Melody was with Revis. They need their hands, he said. They come in with what you did. On Saturday, the team flew to Buffalo to play the Bills, and that evening, before the defensive meeting, I got another cup of ice for my finger. As I walked toward the meeting room, safeties coach Jim O'Neill intercepted me. His voice rising, he told me to get rid of the cup. You're not bringing ice into a team meeting and spreading your softness, he said. It hit me that you never saw an NFL injury report with a player listed as doubtful finger.
That's terrific. Okay, so, and I was just sort of thinking that, you know, if I was ever had the courage to write a book of nonfiction, this sort of should be kind of taken into account, anybody here who's thinking about it. So I just kind of made these notes that in reading your book, I learned that you bought a car in order to make hundreds of trips back and forth between the team and your apartment in New York City. You were given a locker and a coach's uniform and key codes and access to every inch of the facility. You played games with players and coaches. You worked out and ate meals and lived with the team for a year. You sacked out on couches in offices and you lived in hotels with them on the road. You were given a humiliating nickname. You were told many secrets, some of which were newsworthy. They offered you thousands of confessions that weren't newsworthy, players, defensive colleagues. You interviewed hundreds of players, coaches, loved ones, people in support of the Jets. You spent hours inside their homes. You knew their parents, their spouses, their life stories. You had your finger broken by Darrell Revis. You were scolded for icing it. You were scolded for wearing a funny headband during workouts. You were snapped at by a coach who'd had 2 hours sleep for laughing at an actual joke after
a
night
when you'd
had,
read the book.
Yes, 4 hours sleep. You were grabbed and yanked by the general manager for answering a question from a player you knew well because the conversation took place in the locker room. You were so entrenched in the defensive staff that you were given the chance to call plays from the coach's box during the preseason, and you called at least one brilliant play.
Okay, wait a minute. You deserve to hear this. Okay, so this takes place. This is the Philadelphia Eagles are playing the Jets in the fourth exhibition game, and the NFL doesn't like really the population to know this, but in fact, the fourth exhibition game is something that nobody cares about in the NFL. And the reason nobody cares is they don't want anybody to get hurt. So really, the only people who are going to play are superfluous players who are going to get cut and a few people who are competing for the last roster spots. And of course, for them, it's of terrible importance and significance. But as for the team of a whole, they're just trying to get past it, and they're already game planning for the first game of the season. So all you need to know here, I think, is that Ben Kotwika was a Jets coach who had gone to West Point and had flown lots of attack helicopter missions in Iraq. The last preseason game mattered so little that Mike Pettine intended to give the other defensive coaches the experience of calling a play series under live conditions. The day before the game, each of them received a call sheet. Nicky, Pettine told me, study up. He handed me a color-coded, glossy piece of paper with calls from the playbook listed under the various personnel groups and then divided further by the down and distance situation. Be ready, he said. You'll be in control of a multi-million dollar machine. Immediately, there was a sense of panic. From the installs, I had a vague understanding of some of the plays. I had no confidence I'd remember them under pressure, much less know how to select them in relation to the strengths and weaknesses of young Philadelphia Eagles players I'd never heard of. Still, who could resist? I began to work up mnemonics to memorize calls like Odd Wolf Zop Fire Zone, 3-2 Crown 1, Nickel Dog 1, and Dime Spike 1 Vegas, calls that were, of course, mnemonics already. Invariably interesting was the etymology of the call names. Zip Double Field was for Jason Taylor, the former Jets pass rusher, who played his college ball at the University of Akron, whose team was the Zips. Squirrel dated back to the Ravens and referred to the linebacker Jarrett Johnson, whose rural small-town southern childhood was said to involve squirrel hunting and maybe also squirrel eating. As for Dime Spike 1 Vegas, it had its origins in a pass coverage drop Rex Ryan had created in Baltimore for a big defensive lineman named Keith Washington, who'd played his college football at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. In the locker room at the stadium for the Eagles games, we all put on our khaki pants and matching green and white Jets polo shirts and caps. I slipped my folded call sheet into my pocket. Then I removed and unfolded it several times to make notes, reminding myself of things. Golf carts drove us through the stadium tunnels to the elevator, which then delivered us to the coaching box at press level. There weren't enough chairs in the box, so I stood behind the coaches, as I'd done each week. In that little glassed-in room, even though there were spectators right there in adjoining boxes or in seats below, you felt removed from the enormous crowd around you, felt you were sealed off in a capsule that was its own little mind space. Up in the booth, coach after coach had his turn calling defensive plays, passing them down to Coach Thurman, who sent them out to the Mike linebacker. At the very end of the third quarter, with the Jets losing a listless game 21-7, Mike Pettine looked at me. My heart shifted. Nicky, you ready? He said in that even voice of his. Jim O'Neill was going to call the first and second down plays of the drive. The third downs were mine. O'Neill, excited, said something about, let's do this, buddy. I took the seat beside O'Neill, retrieved my call sheet, covered now with so many notations that some calls were illegible. I put on the headphones, thick and warm as earmuffs. On the open defensive channel, I could hear Rex Ryan and Coach Thurman talking down on the sideline. Ben Kotwika, who'd flown night missions in those Apache helicopters, had told me what to expect from the headphones. We've got six people on five radios, and it's just like Baghdad. That headset chirps as much as any radio frequency I was ever on when I was flying. Rex talks to Pet. DT tries to call in the defense. Sut doesn't usually say shit. O'Neill a little bit, but mostly Rex, Pet, and DT. Kotwika believed that if you packaged it right, it's the number one show on TV. It's comedy. Should we challenge a call or not? Trying to get 11 guys onto the field, that fog of battle. Everybody's got a game plan, but things happen and the enemy's got a vote. Patton showed me which button to push to speak. Behind me, Scott Cohen was calling out the personnel groupings. What looked orderly and matter-of-fact when Patton did it now felt as though it was happening very, very fast. I looked at my sheet, trying to follow as O'Neill made his calls, doing a nice job of backing up the Eagles to 3rd and 14. "All yours, Nicky," he said, his voice thrilling with accomplishment. I had no idea what to call. I blurted, "Nickel dog," a 5-man pressure. I like dogs. Then I watched my nice nickel dog leave me, trot smoothly through the wires, stop to get a pat and a command from DT, and then dash out onto the field, where the Eagles' second-year quarterback Mike Kafka showed my nickel dog a trick, completing a 20-yard throw for a first down. My face was scarlet. How can I explain? There was the feeling that Patton had loaned me something, rightfully his, something valuable, something I had no business touching. It was a borrowed sports car I'd wanted to return without scratches, and it already had a big dent. The Eagles' drive continued. Again, O'Neill got to 3rd down, 3rd and 2. Again, he said, "All yours, Nicky." A bit less enthusiastic this time. I'd always liked the sound of Dime Spike 1 Vegas. The call meant that the dime or six defensive back should blitz. Meanwhile, another one of the defensive linemen, in this case Marcus Dixon, would bluff a rush and then make a Vegas drop into short area pass coverage. Quarterbacks didn't expect a lineman to be prowling around back there, and if the call worked, they wouldn't see Dixon. Dixon was a large figure, nearly 300 pounds, but quarterbacks were like most people. Under pressure, they surmised, noticing only what they had seen before. Patton was right. All the sounds around me fell away, and it was intoxicating to be in control of these fast, powerful men, to make what was about to happen on a field far below take place. I felt a little like a puppet master. I spoke, they moved. I called for the blitz, garnishing it with the Vegas drop, and then something amazing happened. Kafka, under pressure, threw over the middle, right where Marcus Dixon's long left arm could reach. Dixon tipped the ball, enabling the defensive back Ellis Langster to intercept the pass and return it 67 yards for a touchdown. In the box, as Langster zoomed toward the end zone, everyone was yelling except for me. I was incredulous and now felt like a drug kingpin who'd been sampling some of his own product. In the aftermath, I was struck by how purely happy the coaches were. The play had worked to perfection, just as its designers had imagined it. Dime Spike 1 Vegas was such a beautifully conceived football idea that rookies and free agents could succeed with it. I could succeed with it. I thought that even as I was completely dumbfounded by the utter luck of it all. And then they said, "You call a pick six, you got to keep going. We found an offense in you." So I quickly drove the Eagles down the field for a game-sealing field goal.
That's beautiful. Should I ask you about how they judge the prized beef correctly? Do you want to talk about that a little bit? There were some things that
I guess
asked.
What I would say, he's talking about really the combine and the draft, both of which I attended.
Well, there's two things that I wanted to talk to you about.
Sorry.
One of them was this one detail from the combine, and the combine is where the coaching world looks at players coming out of college, and there's this moment where a black player says, "You're standing there, it's mostly black guys, we're mostly naked, and it's mostly white guys walking around prodding our flesh and poking us," and he said it feels just like a slave auction. And then there's this other paragraph that's just amazing, and it's just about how when Bill Walsh was the general manager for the 49ers after he'd been the coach, he came back and he was trying to find a new quarterback, and he chose a guy who never played a snap later and became a yoga guru and disappeared off the grid.
And I believe a llama farmer.
And a llama farmer, and the guy who he didn't pick, who he didn't really understand.
Who was a local boy, who was a big fan of the 49ers since childhood, would give anything to be a 49er,
was Tom Brady. So I guess what I'm wondering is, you describe a staff of 8 who travel to 250 places around the year and generate 5,000 pages of scouting reports, and they still don't get it right, I guess.
Right. I think football is – I think they would say that football is – it's an inexact science is the word that they is a phrase they often use for it, and it really is. It was astonishing to me. It's not just 5,000 pages. It's 5,000 reports generated by these 8 guys, and it's astonishing the algorithms they're developing, the portfolios, the stacks and stacks of reports. For every draftable college player, they had at least a 1-hour discussion at the end, right before the draft, and goodness knows how many discussions before it. It was, you would think that you would fall asleep, but there's so much riding on it that the adrenaline coursing through that room is just, it's a locked-in bunker. Even the draft room itself has they have what's called a draft board where they rank all the players by position, and there are a few players who they're not going to draft who have black dots on them. And like on one, I remember there's a photograph of a guy with a gun, which made him sort of untenable for a football team. And so they had his picture with a gun under his black dot. But it's they have this curtain and it's padlocked, and the sign on the door says "Do not clean." I mean, this is very secret, private stuff. But then every other team is doing it. And the thing about it is that every team is evaluating all these guys differently. They're pouring everything into it. And then even if they never know who they're going to draft. And even if they get the guy that they want, they don't know how good he's going to be. And it's just, as you know, the Tom Brady example suggests, it's a fundamentally just, they don't know for 3 years whether they've done well or done poorly. And I think the draft itself points to part of why football is so popular in this country, which is that it's that old Ali Sherman phrase, on any given Sunday, any team can win. Even the worst teams can defeat the best teams. Even players who seem like they're not going to be an NFL-quality player could be a great star like Tom Brady, and even somebody like Vernon Gulston, who the Jets drafted in the first round a few years ago, who was going to be their great dynamic pass-rushing linebacker, never had a sack in the NFL. I mean, they just don't know. And I just found it so, in a funny way, moving how much of these people, they were doing this to the exclusion of everything else in life. And I mean, they weren't sleeping well, they weren't seeing their children, many of their marriages were breaking up, and they were just doing this with a formidable level of concentration, and yet the rate of failure was so high.
I just, you were talking about like the life of an NFL coach during the season, so you have a one-year-old and a three-year-old, and you were writing a book on football, and in your spare time you were probably watching a lot of football, and I wonder how, if you felt any of that, the life of an NFL coach impacting on your own newish marriage?
I should say that yes, it was astonishing to me how quickly I felt sort of out of season in my own life. The NFL, I mean, one of the cliches about it is the huddle is America. There's a little bit of everybody there. And it's the job, and because it's such a itinerant sport, you know, players and coaches are shifting teams very quickly. People are coming and going. The NFL career, I mean, they say NFL, not for long. I mean, careers are so short. The average is less than 3.5 years. So the job of a coaching staff every year is to bring together all these disparate elements and organize them into a collective sense of mutual endeavor. And that is tricky to do. And so they spend all their time together. And so I felt that when I was at home, that I kind of missed the pull of the facility a little bit, but I was also rarely home. But in my spare, during the summer, I was home a little bit, and I'll read you this little passage about what it was like. One of the reasons I could be home a little bit in the summer was that there was a lockout, so the coaches were only working about 10 or 12 hour days instead of more than that. And the lockout meant that there were no players around while they created a new labor agreement. So the coaches, there was a little bit more time during the lockout when the coaches could talk to each other. And I can't ask you to remember all these names, but these are all coaches. And I spent most of my time living, in effect, with the defensive coaching staff. And these are all defensive coaches. As the lockout bore steadily into June, its third month, there were more conversations among the coaches than before about matters unrelated to football. Mark Carrier and I were talking about music one day, and when I mentioned Simon and Garfunkel's song, The Sound of Silence, he said he'd never heard of it. Really? I asked him. Everybody's heard that one. You lived in Los Angeles in the 70s and 80s. You couldn't have avoided it. Carrier insisted that no, he had never heard it. Then, like the great attacking safety he'd been, Carrier went after Simon and Garfunkel. So, Nick, let me ask you something, he said. Those two guys get along, or are they like all those people who have success and end up hating each other? I was about to tell him that he was onto something when DT walked by. Hey, DT, said Carrier, have you ever heard the song The Sound of Silence? DT looked at Carrier. Then he looked at me. You could see him considering the situation, noting who was doing the asking, who was standing next to that guy, and what it all must mean. Finally, the most intelligent cover cornerback of his time replied, no, I might have been aware of it, but I never went ahead and heard it. Another morning, Carrier arrived in the film-watching meeting with a parenting story. The previous day after work, he'd attended his 13-year-old daughter's youth soccer league game where she'd received a yellow card for inflicting violence on an opposing player. Hammer had been one of the most violently penalized players of his time. He accepted chip-off-the-old-block congratulations from the other coaches. Then he was asked how he'd reacted in the moment. Had he said anything vicious to the soccer official? Carrier said he'd just sat there cuddling his dog, Lucky. What kind of a dog was Lucky? Jeff Weeks wanted to know. The kind of little dog Jack Nicholson had in As Good As It Gets, Carrier said. That's a nice dog, Weeks said. Not to Carrier. Hell no, it barks all the time and it shits all over the house, but it's good in traveling and at soccer games. Mike Pettin roused himself. Well, Hammer, why not leave it in the car except for soccer games? Even during the lull, these were coaches, and they were always coaching something. When they learned that at a party for toddlers, my son had interrupted some singing to run across the room and tackle a little girl dressed up as a ballerina in a pink tutu, the coaches were ecstatic, thrilled, and gave me seminars on form tackling technique to pass along to my son. Nick, tell him, lower your center of gravity. Nick, tell him, hit on the rise. Another morning, I encountered Bob Sutton in the kitchen area between the offensive and defensive sides of the coaching pod. Here, there were two coffee options. A fresh pot of Dunkin' Donuts brew was always available, or you could make your own single cup at the fancy Flavia machine, as Sutton was doing. I'd never tried the Flavia. Sutton said that had to change immediately. Then he proceeded to walk me through it. Okay, Nick, he began, get fired up. Proper procedure is everything, Nick. First, Nick, you choose your coffee. I selected French roast, described on the packet as dark and intense. Sutton continued, that choice secure, Nick? Good. Okay, good selection, Nick. Good. Now, you hit that left upper hand button, and you open the machine. Now, have your packet ready, Nick. Ready, Nick? Okay, good. Install that packet, Nick. Got it in there nice and snug? Good, good. Good technique, Nick. We're making progress. Now, close that window, and this is key. You must lock the empty cup under the source or the coffee will not come out. We locked it in, and an aromatic smell filled the galley. Sutton nodded approvingly. Nice job, Nick. Good work, Nick. Enjoy that coffee, Nick.
That's terrific. I was going to ask you, because I coached my daughter's third grade soccer team this year, if you had any tips on coaching for me, but I think I got them all right there. That's...
Might help with the orange juice squeezing.
So after the first two games of the season, the Jets were 2-0, and they were so pleased with themselves that you spend a little bit of time documenting just like the good feelings among the players, kind of complimenting each other, and the sort of tomfoolery where they not only glued Rex Ryan's peanut butter jar shut, but they filmed him trying to open it and talking to himself while he was trying to get in there. But this fun stretch was not to last. And in some ways, one of the most profound things about your book is the fact that it sort of reminds you that a lot of sport is not winning, and that in any given football season, there is only one Super Bowl champion. On this one page, you have all this kind of euphoria on page like 283. And then the next page, you describe this loss to the Raiders. You describe fumbles, blown plays, an injury to Cromartie, who's like everybody prized possession, this terrible, long, brooding flight home, and coaches who like couldn't understand what had happened. It would seem to me that going into any game, there is an expectation that you might lose, and yet for them, it seems that there isn't that expectation. I'm sort of wondering, why is losing such a shock to an NFL team? And then the following week, they get beaten by the Ravens. You describe the Jets line being pummeled by the Ravens' propulsive ferocity. Ravens players later confessed to Jets coaches that some of the Jets actually looked scared on the field. You describe Sanchez being cuffed and smacked around, making him appear like a small boy gone off to sea too young. And later, Pettin, the defensive coach, looked like a gull who'd flown into a window. He was crushed. So I guess what I'm wondering is, I mean, you did spend some time kind of meditating on losing.
Right.
And it's really powerful. And in a way, it's the most powerful element of the book that removes the barrier between me and these Olympian gods who we see on television. And
well,
I wonder if you could just...
Sure. Yeah, I think that, you know, we think of football as a game where, you know, it's a game of triumphs and victory and so forth. But I think that in this country, which is, as you know, a land of feel-good movies with happy endings, that one of the reasons that football is the single most popular entertainment, that it's the national passion, actually, as far as I could tell, had much more to do with disappointment. And I thought that one of the things that seemed clear to me about football was the inevitability of disappointment. After all, there are 32 teams and only one of them can win. The expectation that you're going to win frequently is so often disappointed. 10% of the time plays as diagrammed by the coaches work, so that means 90% of the time plays as diagrammed fail. In other words, all 11 men don't do what they're supposed to do. There's such imperfection in the sport, and I told you what it's like on a Monday morning at the facility after a loss. And it came to me afterwards that, yes, these are people who fail a lot, and that there's a lot of despair in football. I mean, the Jets were an emblematic team that year. Could have been any team. I you know, it could have been the Redskins. It could have been anybody. But because I guess what I felt about them that was emblematic was, well, they were 8-8. But also, I felt that emotionally, the things that happened to Jets people, they said, really were the experience around the league. And as I watched people suffer all this disappointment, at a certain point, it came to me that it wasn't so much about winning. It was really a sport about process. The 16 regular season games are holidays on a calendar, which is really all about working every day, trying to improve at something that is uncontrollable, trying to control the uncontrollable, the delusion that you can do it, and then the necessity of failure, and then the question, what are you going to do with the failure? It seemed to me that football coaches were people who were uniquely good at experiencing failure, knowing disappointment, and then being able to move past it. And we are talking about big public disappointment based on plans that are, they're sleeping in closets at night in the facility. They're sleeping under their desks. I mean, you know, there was one guy who had a camp mattress the night that they would make the game plan, and it was in the meeting room where we watched film, and it would right behind my chair, so I would see it, and he would get 2 hours of sleep, and so you would see the outline or the silhouette of his form there in his little red flannel blanket and his blue sheet, and his form was still in it. It was as though he'd sort of catapulted out of this deep sleep, and his form was still sleeping there, but there he was across the table drinking energy drinks, you know? And, you know, they put everything they have into it, and then so often they lose. And what struck me is that if the inevitability was that they likely weren't going to win, they understood failure and they knew what to do with it. And I thought to fail or to err is human. And this struck me as a much more human part of athletics, that there wasn't the thrill of victory. It was it was being able to understand in some sort of deep and profound way what it was like to lose. That's and be able to move past it. That's what struck me, was what made an NFL coach.
And then just to stay on this terrible part for a moment more. So this section around the Patriots game that followed, the Jets' third loss in a row, particularly harrowing after a messy game filled with penalties, Jets punting, you evoke the awfulness of a poorly lit, badly accommodated visiting team locker room where even like the toilets back up and these big, sad men walking around. And you wrote, there was a stated belief that if you've truly given your all, that was enough. That wasn't enough. And then a little later you said, it was maddening. The coaches had been thinking about the Patriots for months. Well, that was pretty moving. And then there's this, do you want to say something about that?
Yeah, the point is the same as what I just said. It's just, they were thinking about the Patriots in February. And here the game had finally come, and I think it was in October. And all these months later, that Patriots is what they thought about. And then the game comes, and just in this blink of time, it's just gone. And all the things that they had planned were completely disrupted. All their expectations were, the Patriots had anticipated their expectations and done something different. It was just, it was maddening. Mm. And yet, they had to go back to work the next day, and they had to play somebody else.
Mm. How are we doing on time?
We should get to questions.
Okay, I'm just going to ask a couple of quick things here. This is my quiz that I made up of your book. I'm quizzing you on your book here. This is just you can earn a lot of points here at the end, though. Who said this? Is it wrong that I drive a Maserati and get an $8 haircut from Supercuts?
That would be Coach Ryan.
Okay.
A beautiful human being.
Okay.
As we've said.
Okay. Which enormous guy wore a hot pink T-shirt that said, "Don't laugh, I got this T-shirt from your girlfriend"?
That would be the pass rusher Aaron Maben. But the reason... there's a whole story involved. I mean, football, the culture of football is pretty conservative, and I was different. I mean, you know, it is a culture of conformity, and it's an SUV world. I was driving a Mini Cooper. It's a world where at lunch, I would sit with these guys who are eating these big plates of brown foods, and I would be eating a beet salad, and, you know, I was mocked for that. And, you know, it's a culture where when I would go running, sometimes I'd wear a bandana for obvious reasons. And as I was wearing the bandana, sometimes it was purple. And at a certain point, the guy who's running the draft for the team looked up and said, "Nikki, their headband concerns." I mean, and it... But it all was in a way that felt really, really inclusive. It's a complicated subject, and we could talk more about it if you like, especially in light of what's been going on in Miami. But it is a culture of conformity, and if you are different, that's okay, especially under Coach Ryan, who, in my mind, one of his most appealing qualities is that he celebrates a really eclectic range of people. That's not always true in the NFL among coaches. But if you are markedly different, and you rub somebody the wrong way, things could almost casually devolve a little bit. And if you are spending that much of your time immersed in a place where you don't have much else going on in life because you have to be there all the time in these small groups of people, and somebody like Richie Incognito is giving you a hard time and he's a higher status person, it could very, very easily become extremely painful. It's like in, you know, it's like for all of us in junior high school or high school, when somebody's teasing you and it's affectionate, it's nice and you can feel the affection, and generally speaking, you'd enjoy it. But if it's a unkind, cruel power dynamic that's being expressed, you feel that too. And that can make it pretty miserable coming to work every day.
Speaking of which, so Rex Ryan said this about Who. This was after a fight that happened on the field. It would end with both dead, ears scattered everywhere.
That's a trick question, because in fact Mike Smith said it.
There
are a lot of fights in football practice during training camp. It's hot. They're playing really hard. It's a very physical sport. It's very, very competitive during training camp. And there was a debate among the coaches if there were a fight among the two best fighters on the team, who would win? And that's the answer to the question.
Okay.
How many more of these do I have to answer?
I'm just going to ask you one more.
I'm just killing this.
Who did Rex Ryan claim? What was the name that Rex Ryan claimed was the perfect football name?
This is a Chiefs pass rusher named Tom Bahali, but he would always say, he would say it as so it sounded like Timber, but he was saying Tom Bahali. Rex is a really appreciative person. That's one of his really, I think, great qualities as a football coach is that, I mean, what is a coach? A coach is somebody who is deferential about himself and is interested in celebrating and encouraging the abilities of other people. And Rex is really like that. A lot of the public has an impression of him as a pretty bombastic person because, you know, in front of a microphone, he can be bombastic sometimes. But within the realm of a team, this is I would say almost that he has a football metabolism. This is, you know, if you think of the pace of football, it's a little bit like texting, it seemed to me. It's something, there are these brief, intense moments of activity followed by a pause and a time to compose, and then another one, and then another one, and then another one. And Rex's way of making his way through a day was very much like that. Most of football doesn't take place on a practice field. It happens in hallways and in meeting rooms and in film rooms and in the cafeteria. And Rex was responsible for close to 100 people, as are all head coaches. And his way of engaging with people was he would have about 82 seconds for each interaction, but he always made them count. We all know people like this who just, in a brief moment, can say something or elicit something that is actually meaningful. And he was really good at it. And he used that information, I would say, for two principal reasons. One of them was he really got to know the people who were working for him. And in this way, they do more for him. They felt more motivated because they could tell he cared about them. But the second thing is he got to know them as athletes. And most football teams defensively have a scheme that is set, and then there are players who fulfill different roles in the scheme. For Rex, it was much more elastic and creative, and as he learned the virtues and the more esoteric virtues of players on his team, he'd find roles for them, which endeared all. Everybody had a play, and they all had plays named after them and personnel groups named after them. And for a football team, this brings everybody even closer together, and the players and the other coaches really loved him.
Cool.
It's kind of a loving environment. That's why I'm using that word so much. If it's successful. Of course, when they start losing, it can devolve, and it did in this year. And you know, afterwards, I was horrified by some of the things that I saw. You know, I mean, just the way, the strong emotions, the incredibly sort of rancorous criticisms people would make of each other in front of the whole team. And at the end of their year, Darrell Rivas told me, you know, you might have seen some things that were surprising to you, maybe even upsetting, mm-hmm. but it just shows you what a really passionate game football is. This is what it's like. Mm-hmm. So can I answer some questions for you?
Nikki, can you talk a little bit about how you came to write this book? And one thing I'm particularly curious about, when you think of the NFL, you think of a organization that is really tightly scripted, that really thinks about PR, and like, why would they let you... You know, it sounds like you had unfettered access for a year, incredible access. I mean, that seems like a potentially huge risk for them to take. So just talk a little bit about how you came to write the book and that aspect of it.
Sure. I think football is, that's a good question, because I think football generally has been far more difficult for people to write about than most sports. And it does have to do with the access. The players themselves are somewhat inaccessible compared to other sports. They have a mask over their face. They're encased in a kind of an armor. And the team spends most of its time at these facilities, which are walled off, right? And I think that my whole interest in the sport really had to do, they always called me a baseball guy. I didn't have any real expertise in football, but my interest in the sport it really had to do with this, what seemed to me a dichotomy. On the one hand, you had the most popular thing in America people love to watch. On the other, it was all based on plans and even on a language, collision low crossers, you know? I mean, a secret language in a way. And I loved that on the one hand that there was this very public event, which was all based on sort of long private planning. And really, I wanted to see the planning. And it began, when I write my books, I begin them as magazine articles for the magazines that I write for to see if I can sustain it over that time and if it can sustain me. And I was feeling a little adversarial in what I was writing about at the time. So I tried four different ideas. One was climate change deniers. I wrote about a climate change denier. I spent pretty much the first year of the Obama presidency in northern Alabama in a community where nobody voted for President Obama to see how they would respond to our first African-American president over the course of a year. I usually write about somewhat marginal characters, so I spent a lot of time with President Carter because I thought I would write about a president. And for whatever reason, those weren't going to be good books for me. But then I heard Rex Ryan talking on the radio, and he just sounded to me like a big American character. I loved the way he spoke, the rhythms of his speech. I loved his sense of humor. I loved in this, what I took to be a fairly buttoned down and therefore distancing sport for me, how open and how gregarious he was. And I wrote a piece about him for the New York Times Magazine. And when I did it, I'd always wanted to write a book about a group of regulars, whether they were people who were joined together in some sort of purpose, committed purpose, either professional or private, whatever it was. It could have been the Manhattan Project. It could have been a group of doctors. It could have been a group of people planning a political campaign, whatever it was. And I loved that I felt that I had found it in the defense of coaches, that these were seven guys who were there all the time working together, making these plans for something that probably wasn't going to come to fruition. And the reason I think that the Jets let me do it is I think that the piece was okay with them. I think that they liked that there was someone who was curious and enthusiastic about what they were doing and curious and enthusiastic about the people who weren't already famous. In other words, not the most famous players, the most glamorous players, but the real nuts and bolts of the sport. I think they understood my suggestion that football was something that people really loved, and I hope to make people feel a little closer to it. And I think that somebody like Rex Ryan and Mike Tannenbaum, the general manager, are both felt that they, as Mike Tannenbaum used to say, we have a good story to tell, and we're going to let you tell it. So yeah, it was if they'd placed restrictions on me, I wouldn't have done it. And they did give me a locker, and it said Nick Davidoff. And as you're hearing, everybody always calls me Nicky. So it was somewhat surprising. And I thought about it for a minute, and I decided it was because Nick hits harder than Nicky.
There's some questions.
Okay, I'm curious about the obsessiveness that you talk about in the coaches. And it occurs to me, like 53 guys on a team and something like 20 coaches on an NFL team. So if you're the tight ends coach and you have three guys you're coaching for a whole year, what are you doing working for 20 hours a day? What do you have to say in week 13 at 10 o'clock at night that you haven't already said 5,000 times over? What do these guys do?
Well, the tight ends coach, you're right. I think, you know, there are probably sometimes there are as many as four or five, but you're right. There's a limited number of people for certain position groups. And I think, though, that each coach has lots and lots of responsibilities besides coaching individual players. They also have they have to draw up the cards. I mean, I don't know how much minutiae you want on this, but they have to scrutinize at least four games played previously by the upcoming opponent, and then from those games, extract what are the most dynamic and perhaps dangerous for you plays that they have in their arsenal. And so then you have to diagram those plays. In other words, you have to figure out what they're doing and then diagram it so that the scout team can run them in practice. That takes a lot of time. And then each one of them also has other scouting jobs during the beginning part of the week. You may have to scout the opposing, the tight ends coach, I think, usually had to address, maybe he, you know, it's tough for me with tight ends just because I was mainly with the defense and I really only was with quarterbacks.
Talk about the linebackers. So
the linebackers coach is responsible for, you know, for creating whatever blitzes he thinks are going to work best. He's responsible for, you know, perhaps he's responsible for noting what the running game will be, what their best runs are and things like that, for briefing the whole team on the opponent. The briefing of the whole team on a new opponent, many of the players on opposing teams, until they're going to play them, they don't even know who they are. If you said, who's number 89 on you know, Jacksonville, and they're playing Jacksonville next week, until they start looking at Jacksonville film, likely never heard of him unless he's somebody who's really a prominent NFL player. They are immersing themselves each week in the opponent, and that just takes a real lot of time. They're also immersing themselves in their own players. The scrutiny of their own players is really something to see. And then finally, somebody, I remember the tight ends coach for the Jets because he'd been a really fine offensive lineman during his own playing career. He was responsible for drawing up many of the choreographies each week for the linemen. And it was just, I mean, once he'd done it all, he would put it on a chalkboard on Sunday before the game in the locker room so that the linemen come and look at it. And it took him an hour just to write it all down in chalk alone. I mean, all the work that he'd done just in transcribing it took an hour. Yeah. There's an argument to be made that it's somewhat overkill, but the margins are so slim and everybody else is working that hard that I think that is very difficult for anybody to stop working. And that there's one of the things that Coach Ryan would do is sometimes when he would get in his car and he would leave, and then his subordinates would feel that it was okay for them to leave too, so they'd go off and he'd be driving around the neighborhood and then he'd come back and he and Mike Patton would finish the game plan just together because they wanted the other coaches to see their families.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, so why did you choose the New York Jets out of all the NFL teams to write about?
That's an excellent question. I would have been happy, you know, Bob Sutton, who is the Jets linebackers coach and is now the defensive coordinator of the Kansas City Chiefs, once said that the NFL is really one company with 32 branch offices, and the daily structure of NFL life is pretty similar from team to team. It all works on a similar template. So I would have been happy really with any NFL team. It would have satisfied my questions. I chose the Jets. I was really attracted to, you know, listening to Coach Ryan on the radio. I just thought this is a great character. He, in every book, has to have vivid characters, people who are memorable. I wasn't writing for 2011. I was writing for readers who might come to the book years afterwards. And I was also living in New York City at the time, and I had a family, and it would have been trickier if I had to come and spend all my time in Washington because I wouldn't have seen my family. So I felt really lucky that I didn't end up seeing much of them anyway, as it turned out, but yeah.
I have two questions. One is how the players think about injuries, because a lot of them are getting injured, and are they thinking, boy, I just love this game and it's okay for me? Are they thinking, I want to spend a certain number of years with this, make some money, and then get out? That's my first question. My second question, which I can't resist as a Jet fan, is do you think Rex Ryan is an above-average NFL coach?
I'll handle the second one first because it's quicker. I think, you know, when Rex began, he was a young coach, and like anybody who is young at a very, very difficult profession, which there's no preparing for, you don't know how good you're going to be. And I think that in his first 2 years, he went to the AFC championship game in both of those years with a rookie and then second-year quarterback.
Right.
Nobody does that by accident. But I think that, you know, it's a difficult job, and I think there was a lot of learning to be done. I would note, however, far be it from me to say how good he is, but I think that the players all said that there's nobody who is more motivating than him and nobody they'd rather play for. But it is tough, tough, tough in today's NFL to succeed if you don't have at least a pretty good quarterback.
Right.
And he never has had a really good quarterback, and I think that has really been something that is holding him back. I think there's no reason why Coach Ryan couldn't be a Super Bowl winning coach more than once. I mean, I think he's a masterful motivator. He's incredibly seductive. He really cares about his players. I'll talk a little bit about pain, but I'll start by saying that he's that rare NFL coach who sometimes holds his players out of games when they want to play because he'll say things like, you're not sitting this week, you're not a piece of meat to me, and I think you're too hurt to play.
Hmm.
And that, trust me, is not that common, and that's
right.
One of the reasons. They'll go extra for him because he knows how much they care about him. As for pain, NFL, Rex always says, has 100% injury rate. It is a dangerous sport, and people who play it accept it. I mean, on the other hand, and I would also say that any NFL player is lying if he's not telling you that at some point or another he felt fear on the field. We live in an era when everybody that I knew was talking about concussions all the time in the world in which I lived
right.
and traveled. At the facility, nobody talked about concussions, never heard a thing about them.
Really?
And the reason for that is because you can't play NFL football, a sport that is that dangerous and happens that quickly, if you're thinking about getting hurt. If you're thinking about getting hurt and you're going on that field, you're going to get hurt. Or you're going to move too slowly and you're not going to be in the play and you're soon going to be on the bench. It's just not tenable. The game is so fast. I've never, I mean, I stood on practice field every day, and it took me a long time to adjust to just how fast it is. And then there were a couple of players who are faster than the norm, mm-hmm. like Antonio Cromartie and Darrell mm-hmm. Rivas. When you're seeing people who are moving in that intricate a way that quickly with violent intent, it really is something to see, and that points to all the popularity. So all that being said, the NFL is I think a pretty conservative culture, but it does change. And a lot of the things that change it are public outcry. And I think you're seeing right now changes in the NFL because people are so upset about concussions, because people are saying, I'm not going to let my kid play football. People are saying, let those guys, you know, play, but not me. And the NFL takes notice. And so what you get in return is you get younger players are saying that when they started out, nobody ever went to the training room. Like Greg McElroy, the backup quarterback, said that in Alabama, if you went to the training room, you know, you were heckled for this. And in the NFL, he said one of the beautiful things about being in the NFL was that if you go to the training room, if you have something wrong with you, everybody wants you to go to the training room because they want you to be healthy, because it's just better for the team and better for you. So I think the players are happy that there's more concern for them. But as for the actual feelings about concussions, nobody talks about it unless I ask, and even then half of them didn't even want to address it because they leave that to the league and to medical authorities.
Okay, thanks.
All right, so you wrote a book once before about spying, and there was a bit of a conflict in the NFL about coaches, you know, spying on other coaches, and it was really Belichick and the predecessor at the New York Jets. What did you see in the current Jets in terms of that activity and or being aware of it, of other teams trying to, you know, capture or steal information and coaching signals?
Just as I saw nothing like Richie Incognito level bullying, and, you know, what I would say just about that quickly is that I think, you know, the national conversation that's going on about bullying, that the NFL enters it in that way, is only going to affect the NFL, and then it's going to redound to the country in that way. Our big institutions, like football or anything else, we look at ourselves through the prism of them, and we examine ourselves. Just as was true of that, I never saw anything like spying, and I don't know where they would have found the time short of having, you know, they're spending all their time just scrutinizing film and so forth. And, you know, I think Bill Belichick is a really interesting case for people on the Jets, because Bill Belichick is coach of the Patriots. He's really the only person who in a salary cap era has consistently had competitive teams. It's a really, really great accomplishment, and they all really admire him. He's their Melvillian figure. He's the great white whale that they're all, you know, that they're all pursuing. The one, they have no criticism of him. They think he's an exemplary coach. They really respect him, except for one thing. They don't understand why somebody who is that good a coach, who's lucky enough to have who they consider to be the best player in the NFL, Tom Brady, they don't understand why he has to do these things that are slightly dipping into the black arts. They just don't get it. Why does he need to do this? Bill Belichick, in his team resume that's in the media guide, he was the defensive coordinator of the Jets for 3 years. It isn't in the media guide. He won't mention the Jets. They, to them, this is mysterious and strange, and also out of character for his interactions with Jets coaches, which are often very generous. Bill Callahan, who was the head coach at the Oakland Raiders and took them to the Super Bowl, was fired the next year. He got a call out of the blue from Bill Belichick saying, you know, you're a wonderful coach. You'll work and you'll win again in the NFL. Rex Ryan gets private calls from Belichick congratulating him after the fray. After a game, it's all weird and awkward on the field with TV cameras and things. So the real interactions between coaches take place later on their own time.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you all so much for coming.